Hi, this is Dr. Fox. Let's talk about the pharynx. In this video, we'll describe the boundaries between the naso, oro, and laryngopharynx and talk about the major contents of each of these spaces. From this, you'll get a sense of how substances may flow or travel between these spaces. So this is a sagittal view of the pharynx, or colloquially the throat. We call it an aerodigestive pathway because it is a common pathway for both the respiratory and the digestive systems. Now there are three subcomponents to the pharynx, superiorly the nasopharynx, then the oropharynx, and inferiorly the laryngopharynx. Now the nasopharynx is contiguous with the two sides of the nasal cavities. And as air flows in through the nose, through the nasal cavity, it passes through a bony passageway known as the choana, plural choani, because there are two of them, one for each side. And this air passes into the nasopharynx. Now, if we draw a line posteriorly through the soft palate, that's the border between the nasopharynx and the oropharynx inferior to it. That oropharynx is going to be contiguous anteriorly with the oral cavity. And so materials may move either way across a boundary known as the palatoglossal arch. The palatoglossal arch is formed from the two lateral palatoglossal folds, which are the palatoglossus muscles surrounded by oral mucosa. Inferiorly, the oropharynx is separated from the laryngopharynx by the epiglottis and pharyngoepiglottic folds, which are probably best visualized from a posterior view. So this is a posterior view of the pharynx, which has been cut open to reveal the inside. We can see here's the soft palate, which divides the nasopharynx above from the oropharynx below. Here are the choani. Here is the epiglottis, and then here's that pharyngoepiglottic fold. So anterior of this will be a portion of the oropharynx called the fosses, and beyond that, on the other side of the palatoglossal fold, we'll have the oral cavity proper. Below this pharyngoepiglottic fold and epiglottis, we have the laryngopharynx. The laryngopharynx is sitting posteriorly to the larynx, which I am highlighting there. And this represents an opportunity for materials to either enter the laryngeal inlet, so pass through the larynx to enter the exclusively respiratory portion of the respiratory pathway, or continue inferiorly from the laryngopharynx into the entrance to the esophagus, which is about at the inferior border of the cricoid cartilage, which is located here. That inferior border is approximately the sixth cervical vertebra. Now let's take a look at some of the contents of each of these areas. So within the nasopharynx, there are three things for you to see. On the roof of the nasopharynx, we have the pharyngeal tonsil, also known as the adenoid. Inferior to that, on the lateral wall, here is the torus tubarius, which is surrounding the opening for the auditory tube, aka the pharyngotympanic tube, aka the Eustachian tube. This is a passageway between the nasopharynx in the middle ear, which allows for one to equilibrate pressure between the two. If you've ever had your ears pop, if you've changed altitude or depth, that is air rushing through this auditory tube. Just posterior to the entrance to the auditory tube, there is another set of lymphoid tissue, a small set called the tubal tonsil. Now the contents of the oropharynx are much more diverse. So here we're looking at the dorsal surface of the tongue. This is the dorsal surface of the tongue that is in the oral cavity proper. And then beyond this sulcus there, we have the portion of the tongue which is known as the root of the tongue. And we can see that this root of the tongue is very rugose. It's rough, and that's because it's covered by lymphoid tissue that we call the lingual tonsil. Now, this region of the tongue is bounded by two sets of folds. Anteriorly here, we have the palatoglossal folds, which comprise the palatoglossal arch. And posteriorly, we have the palatopharyngeal folds, which comprise together the palatopharyngeal arch. The space between these two folds is known as the fauces, which is Latin for throat. On the lateral walls between the folds, we have two tonsillar fossae. And it's within these tonsillar fossae that the palatine tonsils can be found. Now, just posterior to the root of the tongue and anterior to the epiglottis here, we have the epiglottic vesiculae. These epiglottic vesiculae, during our days, will collect saliva, so they serve as spit traps, so to speak, and this prevents the saliva from triggering the deglutition or the swallowing reflex. This is also an important landmark for laryngoscopy, or visualization of the larynx, in particular with a laryngoscope that has a Macintosh-style blade that fits within the epiglottic vesiculae for retracting the tongue anteriorly, which would also pull the epiglottis anteriorly. And that leaves us the contents of the laryngopharynx. Well, there's not much besides the passageways into the larynx, which would be the laryngeal inlet, and also the entryway to the esophagus, which is at that inferior border of the cricoid cartilage, or C6. But we do have two small spaces known as the piriform recesses. These piriform recesses are just spaces in which food can sometimes be stuck. So that is the pharynx, its regions, their boundaries, and contents. Here is your summary slide. Thank you very much for your time.